All right, everyone, walking into the sunset here. Let me move. But gonna kick off update number 11. Nothing terribly exciting in this one, but some stuff that needed to be done. I'm still not doing anything on the CTIS system. I will, I promise, because that's like the last real major thing that I need to get 100%. It's gonna be kind of a little tinkering stuff in this one, little tidbits that you might want to know about your truck. But let's get it started. All right, so I'm gonna use some SuperClean and clean up my engine bay and under my drive lines and stuff. Kind of a wet day anyways, so there's a ton of grime and stuff all built up. I'll just do kind of a walk around of everything so you can see what it looks like before. Okay, I'm all finished for today anyway. This thing will probably never get fully cleaned. I'm not going to do a full walk around and show you how it cleaned up because everything kind of always looks better when it's wet. So I'll do it tomorrow when it dries off as long as it's not raining. All right, after cleaning up everything with the super clean, one thing I did off camera, all the nasty grime marks from grabbing these door handles working on it, cleaned that stuff up. And then the biggest place that I was able to see is how it cleaned up all around here. I mean, it's obviously not perfect, but I didn't scrub anything. I literally just sprayed it on and then rinsed, sprayed it on, rinsed.
Ba-ba-da-ba-ba. anyways, if you really need to degrease your truck, definitely SuperClean is going to be the way to go. And if you're actually going to scrub and stuff like that, I bet you'd work phenomenally in a pressure washer.
All right, here's going to be a quick little project with turn signal. Now, mine's a little loose. Yours shouldn't do that. It's another problem. But the thing that drives me nuts is it not self-canceling. So you put it on, you go to turn, and then you straighten out. Unlike most vehicles, it doesn't reset itself. I found that there is actually a way to do this by just adjusting it. There's a Phillips head screw here to take this cover off, and then 2 4-millimeter Allen screws. And basically all you gotta do is move it up, and let me get it off and I'll show you. This little tab right here, that's your cancel. And then if you look up towards the top of the steering wheel on this side, there's little teeth that stick down, okay? That's supposed to trigger it to stop. So you don't even actually need to remove it all the way. You could just loosen it and slide it up, and it should do the trick. So I'm gonna put it back together and do that, and then we'll go out and test it. I actually had to lower it just a little bit because the plastic on this side wouldn't match up. But I'm assuming that with it all the way up like that, that's going to be where it's supposed to. And I noticed that the wire for this is extremely tight. So probably the reason why these all come out of adjustment is they vibrate loose. And then if the steering wheel is adjusted all the way up, like I got it right now, it pulls it down and then it doesn't self-reset. Okay, we're out here. Came out to the highway. And I'm just going to hit the U-turn here. This light turns green. There's Bam Bam driving by right there. Alright, let's see if it's going to work. Alright, I heard a click. Woo! It reset itself. I got these to put in. Shout out again to my friends over at Armed Forces Supply. I got these from him on a trade. I'll put some links in the description to their eBay store and their website. From time to time, they get truck parts and stuff in. I'm going to go ahead and install one of each one of these before recording it and then go through. Okay, here's the tools. Wire strippers, wire cutters, a 9/16 regular ratchet here. Probably get away with a wrench too. 10 millimeter small ratchet and socket, and also a wrench. Wire crimpers, a lighter or a heat source. And then as far as parts go, obviously your lights, some wires, and then some butt connectors, some eyelet wire connectors, and then some heat shrink wrap. This stuff you might not actually need, but you'll see later on why. First thing I noticed with the front compared to the rear is the rear ones came with a little pigtail, and there's an extra wire compared to the incandescent ones that say ground. And this needs to go to one of the bolts back here. Well, mine, for the front ones, the marker lights, it didn't come with anything in the ground. I dug out of my wire connectors and stuff, and I made a length of ground wire just spread out from my thumb to my pinky, cut it, and I'm just gonna make my own. These are really easy to disassemble, so I'm gonna go ahead and make this right now to show you. So these are pretty easy to take apart. This wire is actually, the insulation is not fixed to this connector. You can push the connector back and it exposes what's in here.
and it actually fell off, but you have almost like this little C-clip. And then what I did is I snipped right behind here. Now it's ready to go on the truck.
All right, so back there where the 9/16 bolts are, you can also see that there's like a zip tie holding all the connections together. And then you can either reach an arm through here where the winch cable would go, or from the back. And it's pretty self-explanatory, except for the ground. You match up the numbers. Some might be hard to read, like mine are painted over. There's little metal tabs. You match them up with the numbers on the new light, and it should work. All right, those came out good. Tested them, everything's working. It's a really easy project. Probably the worst thing that can happen to you is, it's kind of on my truck, but I'm just gonna let it be. The leads coming off the truck, they're really dry rotted, but everything still fit back on there. If I end up having an issue with the light, I'll look into getting that fixed, but I'm gonna move on to doing the back one now. Okay, the rear is even easier than the front, I think. On the passenger side, there's your bolts right there. I think some of these FMTVs have a cover that goes over this you might need to remove. Mine doesn't. And then this wire holder in here, this is where that 10 millimeter comes in handy. Same thing, it's out back right here. Get that off, it gives you plenty of room to do it. And then the mounting bolts, you're gonna take one of those grounding leads, put it behind there, tighten everything up, and it's gonna work. All right, got both of them installed. Tested them, they're working too. And the last thing I'm gonna need to test on the front and back is blackout lights. Pretty sure they're good. Tried to glance really quick off camera, but I'll confirm with looking through at my night vision. And that's gonna bring me into one more little thing that I did too with the lights. So I removed the blackout drive light from up here, and then I created this pigtail with it for this light bar that I have that's removable, that's infrared. It's made by Goblin Tactical. They have a couple different versions of it. Probably everyone watching this is never gonna drive their truck with night vision, but I already have. I already have a video posted up. The blackout drive lights that come on military vehicles are really useless for actually illuminating. It's meant to see like 20 foot in front of you to make sure you're not gonna drive off of a cliff. This you can see like 650 meters down the road. It's awesome. Makes a huge difference. And I plan to get some more night driving footage, and you guys will see that. That's a full big upgrade on all the lights here. Windshield wiper, washer fluid reservoir in here. All of a sudden mine leaked. Got pissed. I went and bought some nice stuff. After fixing it in one of my early videos, I tilt the cab, it all spills out. Now it leaks out. What it is the pump is in here, and it has a fairly unique grommet where it just pops in. And mine is all worn out and no good. You can see it, it's actually all ripped apart now. It's this little piece in here. Found a replacement. It's a standard like European vehicle one. And in the description, I got a link on Amazon to like a 2-pack of these. I'm just gonna slip it off and put a new one in, and hopefully it'll seal up. The smaller one on the right is the one that was on the truck. Bigger one on the left's the new one. Otherwise, besides it being longer, everything else seems to be the same, which will probably cause it to seal up better. So I'm gonna put it on there and see if it works. I'm not gonna record putting it on because there's no real way to set up the camera unless I had the whole thing apart. But this piece has like the angled part facing into the tank, so it's actually upside down. You put it on the little suction nipple off the pump, and this goes all the way up in between the pump, and this grommet seals, and then this swells in the hole. I hope that makes sense. If you have this problem, you probably understand what I'm talking about. All right, you can see the wider part there is pushed on. I got it pulled out just enough to be able to see, and then you just push it down into that hole. And then put the wires back on top. And I'm hoping that's going to be an easy fix.
All right, I filled it up a little ways and it's not dripping out because normally it'd come out of one of these holes right here. Easy fix. What I did to press it in all the way, because the new grommet, is I flipped the screwdriver upside down with the handle part and put it on top of the pump. And then I used a rubber mallet and hit the screwdriver down. You feel it pop into place. I'm sorry this wasn't a very good recording. It was just very challenging to have a way to put the camera and show it in there without disassembling everything. But basically you can pull your wire off the top, mess with the pump, it'll come out. It won't come out all the way because the hose is routed, at least on my truck. You just slip the grommet off, put some O-ring lube on the new one, slip it back onto the pump, get it in place, pop it down, put the wires, hook it back up, and you should be good to go.
I was having a problem with this thing vibrating like crazy. I mean, it's still probably going to vibrate, but there was no anything holding it in the corners, so I drilled a quarter inch hole and used some of my body panel hardware. I also put an extra one right here, and the seatbelt will hold that down, and then one in that corner, and I'm thinking it's going to help a lot with the vibration on this. At least I hope anyway. If not, there's other spots like right here and stuff that I could just drill more holes and put it in. I might actually just do that. Okay, it's been an on and off rainy couple of days. I got the dash apart and the backlight behind my fuel gauge hasn't been working, and then also all my dashboard switches except these two, the backlights weren't working. So I'm gonna try to get those fixed. Here's your bulbs for the switches, Sylvania 2721. Thanks, Neil, for making the video on this and sharing it with me on the group. I'm glad I could fix this. These are the only tools you need to get into the dash, just a real small Phillips. You're going to use this to take the little knob off the throttle control, and then also to help you unlatch getting where the little bulbs are. 7mm for taking off all the little bolts around the dash. I just do it with like a screwdriver. All right, on the fuel gauge, it doesn't look like I'm going to be able to fix the backlight. It started off with it flickering from illuminated all the way like it should to dim, and then it stayed dim for a while, and then it went from dim to off, flickering, and now it basically doesn't work at all. I thought at first that this little black fitting right here, you'd pop it out and there was a bulb. It's not. It's just kind of like a little bulkhead fitting, and all the ground connections and stuff here are good. I don't know. I don't know if they use an incandescent bulb, but there's an LED and there was some power surge and it jacked it up, but the gauge does work, just not the backlight. So I'm just going to have to accept that for now until I can find another gauge. Okay, I'm just going to show you guys on this one. So the hazard light. This one's actually kind of jacked up. My tabs are broken, but to remove these, here's a new switch. There's squeeze tabs on each side. You'd squeeze them and then it pops out forward. And then you remove your two little wire harnesses from the back. These two bottom ones that are smaller, this is where your bulb is. There's a little notch right there. You use a little screwdriver or something. Press it down. It'll release it like a buckle, and then you pull it out. And you can see there's the little bulb. What's also in here, you can see this one must have got really hot and actually melted, so convenient for me, there's like a little cover that goes over the bulb that I guess helps diffuse it so it's not so bright. That's just staying in place, but hopefully that doesn't fall completely out of yours or whatever. Anyways, they just simply pop out, pop in, and I'm going to test to make sure it works. It doesn't matter the polarity on this. All right. So that one works. Make sure that the bulb is going to line up with the little diffuser in there. Pops back into place. and you'll put it back where it needs to go. Not that hard. Wanted to splice in this quick note. That first one, I said it looked like maybe the bulb melted it a little bit. They've all been like that I've pulled out, and you can see this one is pretty extreme. Having a hard time getting it out, so you might really need to wrestle with this. And I mean, if it's bad enough, I don't know if you're going to be able to do it without busting the switch, but just be careful.